Please be seated. Good morning. Welcome to this beautiful Sunday morning. Our Heavenly Father has made for us to come together as a congregation in praise, prayer, worship, song, and celebration. Are there any announcements from the congregation at this time? I was handed this announcement. Those that are interested in helping with next week's Bible school, meet in Sunday school room downstairs after church. The Bible school is next Sunday, August 4th at Sulphur Springs Firehouse. So volunteers are needed and appreciated. Are there any other favorite announcements? I have Parkinson's. I'm not diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. Prayer request at this time. Praise. Yeah.
Prayer for Denise
Holzhassel. Okay. Anyone else? Let us pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for our time together today. We ask you for your blessings, for your promises of prayer and requests, that we should all times and all places heed your word and understand that Jesus did come to us to save us from ourselves. We ask you to be with Denise Holzhassel and anyone else in medical treatment at this time. Be with all those who are in service to our country, protect them, bring them home safely to their wives, their families. Your son's precious name we pray. Amen. Pastor.
Please stand if you're able. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
The Lord be with you. We join together in praying the prayer of the day as printed in our bulletin insert. O God, your almighty power is most clearly shown in your mercy and pity. Multiply your grace that we may run to your promises and be made to share in your heavenly joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I believe for every drop of rain that falls, a flower grows. I believe that somewhere in the darkest night, a candle glows. I believe for everyone who goes astray, someone will come to show the way. Oh, I believe. I believe above the storm, the smallest prayer will still be heard. I believe that someone in the great somewhere hears every word. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry, or touch a leaf, or see the sky, then I know why I believe. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry, or touch a leaf, or see the sky, then I know why I
believe. Good morning. The first reading is taken from Genesis 9. God said to Noah and his sons with him, "Behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. It is for every beast of the earth. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." Here ends the reading. Psalm 136 will be read responsively. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever.
Thanks to the God of gods, for his mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord of Lords, for his mercy endures forever.
Only does great wonders, for his mercy endures forever.
Who by wisdom made the heavens, for his mercy endures forever.
Who spread out on the earth upon the waters, for his mercy endures forever.
Who created great lights, for his mercy endures forever.
The sun to rule the day, for his mercy endures forever.
The moon and the stars to govern the night, for his mercy endures forever. The second reading is taken from Ephesians 3. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Here ends the reading.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 6th chapter. Immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had taken leave of them, he went up on the mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and he was alone on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. He meant to pass by them, but when they saw him on the sea, they thought it was a ghost and cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. He immediately spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." And he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased. And they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, for their hearts were hardened. When they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret and moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countryside, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and implored him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well. The Gospel of the Lord. I'd like to begin with a prayer. And so we pray, gracious Lord, Surround your servant David with your comforting presence, with your loving care. Give him the courage to face his diagnosis with the sure confidence that he does not walk alone, never alone, but that you walk with him and you will give him the courage to face the future, for he is in your care now and always. As we lift him before you, confidently praying in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. I thank you, David, for sharing this with the congregation. You're not alone. Not only does the Lord walk with you, but all these people are there for you too. We're all here for you. We recently, my wife and I, saw a church signboard on our way to worship here with the following message, which fits, I think, well with our gospel lesson. It was two lines. The first line ended with a question mark. It read, "Looking for a lifeguard?" Question mark. The second line ended with exclamation point, which read, "Ours walks on water." It's kind of cute, isn't it? It's kind of stayed with me. I thought, I'm going to use that. And here I am. Looking for a lifeguard, ours walks on water. So our gospel lesson today follows last Sunday's text where Jesus fed the thousands. When all were satisfied, Jesus sent the disciples off in a boat, and he went off for some alone time. We're told that Jesus went up on a mountain to pray. Jesus had had a tremendously busy day. I think some of us can see ourselves in what Jesus did. Alone time. Time for prayer. Well, the disciples were obviously great people, but they must have been in Jesus' hair all the time. I mean, after being part of the miracle of the feeding of thousands with five loaves and two fish, wouldn't they want to talk with Jesus about it? But Jesus was tired. And so he pushed the disciples off in a boat and said that he would meet with them later. He was so depleted, one would think, from the energy it must have taken to heal and to teach all day long and then deal with the disciples wanting him to end the day and send the people home and then deal with the disciples' hesitancy and doubt. Now, I don't know about you, but I need some alone time. Now, I know that not everybody does. But at the end of the day or the beginning of a new day, some of us need some moments just to be alone. It would be like Jesus, a time for prayer, a time for simply shutting down and processing, gathering our thoughts together, or simply doing nothing. For Jesus, alone time was about process. He did process through prayer. He would work out with God what was next. Maybe even more so, he would assess the criticism and the lack of respect and then choose the path still of continued service and move forward. And he did so because he felt this was God's mission for him. Too much alone time is usually not good for us, but some of it can be essential, a time for us to regroup and refocus. Mike Danton was a National Hockey League player. He was in the prime of his playing career when he was arrested and sent to prison. It was alleged that he had conspired to put out a contract on his agent and former junior hockey league coach. He was only 23 years of age at the time, but he had a lot of alone time. He regrouped and refocused. In his alone time in prison, he recognized that he had made some terrible decisions and that indeed he did deserve to be in prison. He also realized that he was on the path that led to nowhere good and began to think about his purpose in life. And part of that process led him to enroll in correspondence courses at Queen's University in Halifax, Nova Scotia. After serving his prison time at age 30, he enrolled at St. Mary's University in Halifax, where he studied psychology and criminology, carried a near 4.0 grade point average, and played on the college hockey team. And since the college was in Canada and he is a Canadian, he was eligible to play. He led his university team to their first national hockey championship and was awarded the Academic All-Canadian Award by Canadian Inter-University Sports. One professor said of a paper he completed for him that in all his years of teaching, it was the best work he had seen from a student, and this from a young man who had attempted suicide in prison. After hockey practice, classes, and intense study, he would spend time, or some time alone time, thinking about his vision and his purpose, which in his own words was, and I'm quoting, to have a family, to have kids, be a great dad, just the usual normal stuff, you know. In our alone time, we might think of this former professional hockey player who had it all, but in the end only wanted what most of us have and can fail to appreciate. Fast forward to today, Mike Danton is a happily married man and a father, and now the owner of the Mike Danton Hockey Academy. In a recent interview, he said, "I'm happy with my life and myself." Jesus, in his alone time, prayed for the wisdom to appreciate who he was and what God wanted him to be all about. And so when the storm came up on the Sea of Galilee, he thought about the disciples, the ones he had sent out in a boat. And he knew that he had to go into the world again and save some lives, that of the disciples on that raging sea. The disciples had been in that boat a long time, fighting the wind for almost the whole night. Jesus came to them walking on the sea in the midst of that raging storm. Natural disasters. Hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes, floods. We all know the destructive power of a hurricane in terms of lives lost and property destroyed. The same can be said about the destructive power of a tornado, having had one touchdown in Bucyrus not all that long ago. The so-called Great Hurricane of 1780 killed over 25,000 people. The three most destructive earthquakes in recorded history took over 369,000 lives. Floods have been destructive. The 1998 Yangtze River floods in China left 14 million people homeless. If you'll bear with me, I can remember from, I don't remember if it was elementary school or high school, when we were in choir, we learned the song Red River Valley. Any of you remember that? Does that ring a bell? From this valley, they say, you are going. I will miss your bright eyes and sweet smile. Sing along if you'd like. For they say you are taking the sunshine that brightens our pathway a while. And then it goes with the chorus. You all recognize it. Come and sit by my side if you love me. Do not hasten to bid me adieu. But remember the Red River Valley and the cowboy who loved you so true. Now, I probably didn't have to read all of that to you, but it did bring back memories, because back in 1997, I had to look it up, but the Red River Valley was in the news. And you might remember that it flooded. Now, I associated the song with what I heard on the news, and it kind of really caught me off guard, but I went back and looked, and I saw that there were 118 lives lost in that flood in 1997, and that in 1826, the Red River Valley flooded. It was the largest flood in the Red River Valley of all time. And there have been numerous floods since then, not only that one in 1997, but a flood that took place most recently in 2009. So the Red River Valley floods, and a lot of lives have been lost and property destroyed. We have this situation where we find ourselves confronted by a lot of natural disasters. And there are a lot of statistics that go along with that, but we don't need to have a lot of statistics to know the power of nature. Maybe someone you know perhaps has lost a relative or a friend in one of these natural disasters, be it a flood or a tornado, a hurricane, or an earthquake. Now I think the gospel last week and this week include the account of hunger and a violent storm to tell us that in both cases, Jesus came in the midst of need. He did not deny the power of hunger or of a storm. He did not run from them. Instead, he entered into the very midst of them. Now, this doesn't mean that we can throw all caution to the wind, because Jesus will be there to calm the waves. The waves he will calm are in us. Let me repeat that. The waves that he will calm are in us. We occasionally hear about people sailing into dangerous waters patrolled by pirates. A spokesperson for the United States Central Command says that over 660 people are now being held by pirates for ransom. One couple was distributing Bibles to native languages around the world. They were killed by pirates. Did they think God would keep them safe no matter what, no matter where they traveled? Or did they just feel so strongly about their mission that they were willing to risk their very lives? Well, in the same way, God obviously doesn't send Jesus to rescue those in peril from natural disasters, even though we hear of many miracle stories. What Jesus does demonstrate is that he will come into any danger, even a raging storm. When Jesus reached the frightened disciples in the midst of that storm, they thought he was a ghost. How could anyone think that it was other than a ghost? That it was a ghost walking on water. That's what they thought. But it was Jesus, and come he did. After all, the one who created the waters could certainly walk on it. Jesus, the Son of God, has power over creation. He can create food. He can walk on water. He can heal. He can raise the dead. Jesus came to the disciples walking on water, walking on the sea in the midst of a raging storm. No storm will ever keep Jesus from us. Jesus recognized the disciples' fear, and then he said to them, "Take heart. It is I, do not be afraid." The disciples were afraid, but the presence of Jesus calmed their fears. The presence of Jesus calmed their fears. And so, demonstrating his mastery over the wind and the waves for a second time, Jesus calms another storm. In times of fear and uncertainty, it is calming to know that Jesus is always with you, always. To recognize Jesus' presence, to recognize his presence, is the remedy for fear. What we don't want to forget is that Jesus comes to us. He can walk on water. He can provide bread to feed thousands. But in all cases, he wants to engage our help. One of the great agencies for help in need around the world is the agency we know as Lutheran World Relief. The Red Cross, Food for the Poor, the Salvation Army, and so many other agencies all work for the sake of the hurting because of compassion. For Jesus fed the hungry out of compassion. Jesus rescued the disciples in that raging storm because of compassion. We have, you and I, compassion within us. We have compassion within us. We not only want Jesus, of course, to come to us in our needs, right? In the storms we encounter, but hear this. He says to us, you too can enter into the storms of life and do good. And so we pray. Gracious Lord, when storms threaten and we have no safe harbor, come to our rescue. Come and save us. For it is in your most holy name, Lord Jesus, that we pray. Amen.
Please rise for the Apostles' Creed on page 65. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into heaven. And the rosary raised again, descended into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father, who will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Thank you. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, we know that you discipline those you love and guide the sinners in doing what is right. Take away our selfish desires so we might live according to your divine will. Open our ears to hear you speaking to us so we will repent from seeking our own ways and turn to you for mercy, grace, and forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy. Timeless God, you are Lord over time and have provided your people with times for work and for play, for toil and for rest. Be with those who are taking vacations so they may find respite and delight in the change of routine, pleasure in the beloved one's company and safety in their travels. Lord, in your mercy. God of peace, may you gently reign of justice and peace prevail around the world. Bring peace to the places that are torn apart by war and violence. Make the walls of hatred that divide homes, communities, and nations crumble under your powerful love and righteousness. Lord, in your mercy. O God, keep us ever mindful of those around us who are grieving or despairing as they deal with tragedies and difficulties in life. Shower the hurting with your abundant grace and love. Show us ways in which you might shine the light of your presence into their darkness. We uplift to you and name in our hearts all those you have blessed with your healing presence. Lord, in your mercy.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.